Actually, the topic for me, yesterday we talked about this long-term medical management of the endometriosis, and I will touch a little bit which one is the good for which patient, progestin or OCP. As you know, endometriosis from the ASRM some years ago, as you know, this is the lifelong management plan. It is a chronic disease. That's why we have to avoid the repeated unnecessary surgical procedure. This is our main idea. The another thing, Dr. Oud from Holland would say, the disorder we cannot diagnose and treat is the most expensive disease. I agree with you. And I believe endometriosis is a typical example for this one. What is the current treatment options? This is from the Dr. Ferraro from Italy, and this is a good clarification. You can see estroprogestin is the first line therapy. They are cheap, they are the first line therapy. And if you look at the FDA approval, this is the article from the Fertility 5 years ago, and I updated this article in the current conditions. There is no FDA approval for the oral contraceptives, which is important. Only progestin, I mean, MPA and Nita is approved. GnRH agonist is approved. And recently, 2 years ago, GnRH antagonist elagonist is approved. As you know, from the old times, danazol is approved. There is no approbation for the Mirena and the letrozole. And again, just I want to remember to you, no drug is currently labeled, I mean for the FDA, for adenomyosis so far in the world. When is the medical treatment? As a first line, I believe pain, deep endo, extra genital endo, adenomyosis, and maybe before IVF. As you know, the other indications prevent recurrence after surgery, not suitable for surgery. Empiric therapy, I will touch on this one. Recurrence after the excision or medical therapy plus surgical therapy. That summarizes this slide. What is the generally accepted indications? We are agree all of us, pain and prevention of recurrence. What is the controversial indications? Primary prevention, is it necessary or not, or is it useful? And these are three items is important. These are contraindications for medical therapy, suspected malignancy, ureter, and bowel obstruction for the deep endometriosis. When we are talking estrogen progestin, we are saying combined OC, transdermal pills, or vaginal rigs is available in that country. Let's start with the oral contraceptives. These are the mechanism of the treatment for oral contraceptives in endometriosis. As you know, OC do not destroy endometriosis lesions, but prevents retrograde menstruation. It inhibits aromatase expression. It serves as a desuturization atrophy in endometrial tissue, inhibition of ovarian function, increase in apoptosis, and as you know, risk ovarian cancer decrease, which is important in this subject. The first question was, could we use any medication for the primary prophylaxis? Only we have just a few studies. One of these from Australia. They look at the self-reported endometriosis in their patients, and they show us OC use reduced the risk of the endometriosis in porous women, but increase the risk of the nulliparous woman, which is important. Another article from Paolo Vercellini, this is the meta-analysis 9 years ago. They look at the 18 studies and they show us if patients current OC users, the risk of endometriosis decreased. But for past users or for ever users, unfortunately, the risk is increased a little bit. Another important question for the OC and endometriosis relationship, this is from the Chapron group. They look at the with or without endometriosis as a cross-sectional study. they say history of OCUs for severe dyspareunia in the teenage and the early 20s is associated for the later life deep endometriosis, which is very, very important. But this confirmation so far, it didn't approve it for the other ones. How about the empirical treatment? Do we need? Yes, we need it. Good guidelines. They say you can do it empirical treatment without laparoscopic confirmed diagnosis. And Ashley says in the recent guideline, if she has suspect endometriosis, no surgical indication, and pain must be symptom, you can go directly empirical medical treatment, either OC or progestin. Let's look at what we have so far for the OC about the endometriosis. As you know, drospirenone and ethinyl estradiol, 24 plus 4 day, we are using nowadays very much. And one of them is from the Italy. They look at the WAST score and they look at the diameter of the endometrioma and they say dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia is decreased when you are using the OC and the endometrioma diameter is decreased. It's important. Another study is from the Harada group. They are working on this issue very much. And they look at the, again, pain and the size and volume of the endometrioma in the nearly 50 patients. And they say, even in the one cycle, after one cycle, the pain is decreased and the ovarian endometrioma size is decreased if you use the OC. If you use the OC as an extended regime, they compared the, again the same group, flexible regime, placebo versus dienogest. They say dienogest and the flexible OC usage is the same efficacy if you compare with the placebo group. How about the meta-analysis? This is one of them. They say, please look at the conclusion. The available literature suggests that very, very low quality, insufficient data to reach the conclusions OC is useful for the endometriosis. At the same year, this is the last Cochrane database about OC use for pain in endometriosis. See, just 5 trials, say nearly 600 patients, and the conclusion is the same conclusion. There is no good quality data, unfortunately. Which method is good for us? Continuous versus the cyclic usage. The literature says continuous OC usage is better than the cycle OC usage. But the problem, discontinuation rates, especially for the irregular bleeding, is higher in the continuous method than the cyclic OC usage. Is OC usage is useful for the deep endometriosis? Yes. This is again from the Milan, Italy, this study. They say, and if you use the 1 year OC, pain score is decreased, all of them. See, dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia, and painful defecation, and other deaths. And the reduction of the nodule is observed 1 year usage. How about the adolescent period? It's very, very important. It's the ECOG guideline. They say you can use first line therapy, either OC or progestin or Milana. All of them have shown same effect for the teenage girl. And in this period, after the operation, you can use the OC. This is coming from the South Korea. You can use the OC after the operation in teenage girl. It is useful, especially if you use the 3 or 6 months generic followed by cyclic OC in this group. How about the OC usage is infertility in endometriosis patient? Only we have so far just one publication from Dominic Ziegler. They show us if you use 6 to 8 weeks before the IVF, the chance of the IVF is increased, but only just one paper. Now we are waiting this protocol, and Holland Netherlands Group, they look at the, they are looking now, OC versus GnRH before the IVF for the endometriosis patient. This is the protocol. We will see the results. As a summary, for the endometriosis types, if we talking about the peritoneal endometriosis for the OC, there is no data. For the ovarian endometrioma, cyst size is unchanged or decreased, and postoperative medical therapy must be advisable. For deep endometriosis, if patient is happy with the medical treatment, you can go with the medical treatment without surgery. No benefit of preoperative therapy, advisable postoperative therapy after the deep endometriosis. My take home message, especially for the young ones, this is not approved for the endometriosis. I mean, FDA approved, but widely used off label in my country, in other countries. The level is the B level for all effectivity. Continuous treatment is important, especially for dysmenorrhea, and you can use after surgery, but for the chronic pelvic pain and dyspareunia is not so effective. And for the endometrioma recurrence is effective, but as you know, OC has some estrogenic side effects, as you know. This is my slide, it can be arguable. According to my knowledge, evidence-based medicine for the endometriosis OC usage, primary prevention, no data, infertility, no place, preoperative, no data, pain, dysmenorrhea, A, the other ones, C data, postoperative, B data, before IVF, one study, deep endometriosis, B data, umbilical, not enough data, extragenital, no data, adenomyosis, B data. As I said, this is arguable, this is my slide. How about the progestin? Let's speak about a little bit of progestin. As you know, we are using progestin last 70 years. But again, to remember you, none of them were developed to treat endometriosis, even in diagest. Oral route, as the NATA, digesterone, MPA, diagest, intramuscular MPA, intrauterine Mirena, and for the progesterone pill, digoxestrel, drospironone, and implant, etanogestrel. These are all effective for the endometriosis. And for the digesterone, this is the old publication, but it says if you use the hydrogestrone, you can get the good improvement for the pelvic pain, dysmenorrhea, and dyspareunia. Another option we are not using in our country, but especially in the North America, they are using very much MPA Depo-Provera for each 3 months. This is effective, it is simple, but it has really bad side effect, especially for the abnormal bleeding, but FDA approved treatment. How about the Mirena LNG releasing intrauterine system, which is very, very good for the, especially for the adenomyosis patient, but I would like to suggest pre-treatment with GnRH markedly reduced LNG expulsion, because one of the main problem, the expulsion of the Mirena in adenomyosis, especially for diffuse adenomyosis patient. If you use pretreatment GnRH, it will be very good for the patient. Let's see the famous DNAGES we are using in our country. I believe you are using. DNAGES looks like unique progesterone for the endometriosis. This is the first systematic review. It is really effective for pelvic pain, for the endometriotic lesions, and for the tolerable side effects for the long term. It is important. This slide is from my friend Thomas Römer from the Köln, Germany. This is his slide. As you see, if you use the DNAGES after the endometrioma excision, the risk of the recurrence is very, very low, nearly 2% when we compare with the placebo. And either DNAGES is effective for the deep endometriosis patients like OC. See, this is the study, and it says 2 milligram DNAGES is effective after one year for deep endometriosis, which is important. The another hot topic, especially in Italy and other countries, which one is good as a progestin, Nita or DNAGES? This is the head-to-head study from Versalini group. They say the same efficacy. But if you look at the side effects and tolerability, the analgesic is much better than the Nita. Another study just came again from the Italy, Milano. They look at the analgesic versus Nita, the same efficacy as you see, but if you look at the dysmenorrhea, chronic pelvic pain, and dyspareunia, and the side effects, the analgesic is better than the Nita. And how about the side effects? One of the major side effects for the long-term progestin used, especially the analgesic used, is the decrease of the bone mineral density. As you see the one-year report from the Korea in this paper. Another study just published last month, and again from the China, they look at the 3 years treatment. Again, you see the, and the, especially for the vertebra and the femur area, the chance of the risk of the, actually risk of the bone, risk of the decrease of the bone mineral density is very high. It's very important for the long-term use of the analgesic. How about the efficacy of the analgesic of the teenage girl? This is the one study from the, we called Bizado study. They look at the, what is the efficacy of the, pain in teenage girl. The same efficacy like the adult woman. There is no problem, but the problem, again, there is problem with the bone mineral density, the degrees of the bone mineral density, approximately 2.3%, but after the finished operation, 6 months later, a little bit recovery of the bone mineral density has observed in this study, partial recovery after treatment discontinuation. Is Dianogenes is effective for the adenomyosis patient? Yes, this is the good study from the, again, Japan group and from Osaka group. They look at the pain score and they say it's good if you compare with the placebo group in adenomyosis patient to usage of Dianogenes. And let's see a little bit, how about the progestin usage for the IVF patient in endometriosis. This is just published, this month published from the Japan group. They look at the, is, as you know, recently, last 2 years, we are doing the progestin primed ovarian stimulation instead of the GnRH antagonist. And they show the, if you use the DNAgest, its effectivity like the other progestin, the didragosterone or MPA, the same efficacy, which is very, very important for the future, this study. How about the usage of DRGS before the IVF? If she has failed IVF cycle, if you use 3 months or 6 months DRGS before the IVF, you can get good result, I believe, but we have to approve this one. This is just published. And that's why it looks like if you use it before the IVF diagnosis, maybe it's useful for the IVF patients for the get the more pregnancy. How about the discontinuation and non-response problem for the diagnosis patient? This is from coming from the, again, my friend Michael Miller from the Switzerland Bern. They look at the, why the some people don't respond and disconnect the discontinuation of the DNAGS. They say during the bleeding and or early stage AHRM are independent risk for the non-response. If she has before the treatment primary dysmenorrhea and suspicion of adenomyosis is interesting, it's, that means non-response is increased. We have to think about this study. This is just published this week, and they look at the, what is the recent analysis about the recurrence following postoperative hormonal suppression. As you see, for the progestin, we have just one study. It is effective. For the combined oral contraceptive, 6 study, it is effective. And as we thought. How about the deep endometriosis? Could we use this drug? Yes. See, progestin and combined OC has a great efficacy for the deep endometriosis. How about the adenomyosis? They have the good response for the progestin, either OC for the adenomyosis patient. This is again my slide. It's arguable. For the progestin, I mean not the dynagest, for the all of them. Primary prevention, no data. Infertility, FIV study. Preoperative, no data. Pain is more effective. Recurrence, B. Postoperative, B. Before IVF, FIV study. Deep, A. Umbilical, no data. Extragenital, FIV data. Adenomyosis, I mean B data. What is the problem if you compare with the OC versus progestin? This is a very good comment from the Versalini 2 years ago. I agree with him. He says OC studies are low quality, no random, no placebo. But if you touch the GnRH agonist, antagonist, especially the Dionegast studies are more high quality. The problem is the pharma industry. I believe it's very, very important when we evaluate the paper about the these drugs. It's very, 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 very important. Again, this is my comparison: continuous OC versus the Dionegast. As you see, both of them hypoestrogenic side effects. No application oral, and the cost is low for the OC, moderate for the Dionegast. Bleeding is good for the OC, not for the Dionegast. And the age of patient after 40, OC is the not so good, but the Dionegast is good. And for approbation, as you know, OC no, and the Dionegast is yes. How about the prospective randomized studies, the Dionegast versus OC? As far as I know, there is no RCT about this one. The Dionegast versus GnRH analog, same efficacy. The Dionegast versus Nita, same efficacy. Again, the Versalini group says OC should be used as first line treatment in low and intermediate risk, or progestin therapy has to be used for high risk, especially for deep endometriosis or contraindications for the OC patients. And medical treatment, unfortunately, not always is the useful for the patients. As you see from the study from the Becker, from the Oxford, and they say their particular review, some people has no response, and some people recurrence, and some people side effects after the medical therapy, either OC, progestin, or GnRH. Is there any ideal drug for endometriosis? The answer is unfortunately no. That's why we need the new drug. There is no new drug so in the pipeline, as far as I know. It's important. This is my last slide. Again, this is arguable. In my practice, in our group practice, we choose depend on the conditions, OC or the progestin. And nowadays, progestin is a little bit more chosen for the patients. For the second choose, I believe elagolix, which is not in our country, only I believe in North America has this drug, GnRH agonist plus EDVEC. And especially for adenomyosis patients, we have to use the Mirena. Third choice, low dose danazol intravaginal. I use this drug sometimes for the intravaginal, it is effective. And aromatase inhibitors, especially perimenopause or after menopause patient. And the last choice, as you know, the laparoscopic surgery. This is my last two slides. This is the Asia Campus workshop online. And this is the EAS webinars. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for excellent presentation. Really, endometriosis is a chronic disease. And this disease needs in lifelong therapy. And my question for you, how long you use progestin, especially Dynagest, after laparoscopic surgery in patient with endometriosis? How long?
Very long term. I have done some patients more than 5 years. And if she has the not side effects, if she is happy with the drug, I am using long term, and mostly I am using 1 year. It's like must. But after my 1 year, it depends on the condition. If she has no need for the fertility, if she has no problem with the drug, I continue with the same drug. Long term.
What is instruction for this drug in your country? For example, in Russia, in instruction for the NRGST, we have possibility to use this drug just 15 months. And after that, this is off-label administration, and this is very difficult according to the justice in our country. What's in your country? It's
Actually, no problem. In my country, there is approbation, but there is no time limitation. 1 year, 2 year. That's why we have no problem.
Thank you. Mama Eljafut would like to ask questions. Would you like?
Dr. Engin, thank you for the excellent talk, and I'm very happy that we have the same mind in treating endometriosis.
Thank you.
But one comment regarding dynergest in adenomyosis. We know one of the side effects of dynergest is abnormal uterine bleeding sometimes. And in adenomyosis, with my experience, I found it very difficult to control the bleeding episodes, and they are more increased in the adenomyosis group rather in endometriosis. So I don't use dynergest for adenomyosis. What's your own experience in this?
In my experience, the efficacy of 50% in my experience. Some patients has the good efficacy, some not. That's why in this kind of patients, I prefer Mirena instead of the dynergest.
Yes.
Thank you. I have a question.
Thank you very much. Yes. And dear colleagues, we will continue our section.
I have a question, Dr. Natalia, just regarding the data that Professor Engin presented on osteopenia in dynergest. This is slightly alarming in comparison with the initial studies that merged with the start of dynergest use, the Japanese studies with comparison of up to 5 years of the metabolic function. Do you have any other clinical observations on that, Professor Ural? Mainly the effect of dynergest. We know that Depo-Provera has that clearly, but what is your emphasis on this point, which is very crucial if we continue, or like you're saying, if we're talking about lifetime management?
You mean the bone mineral density?
Correct, yes, the bone density effect that you presented in the Chinese
study. That's why I present you, because it's very important. In my patients, I am doing BMD every 2 years. For the long-term patients, I see the, unfortunately, 2% decrease. It's very, very important, especially for the age after 35 in this kind of patients. That's why I prefer, for these patients, I prefer calcium and vitamin D for the support of these patients. Sometimes I spoke with this one, with the other endocrinologists, they say you can use the some anti-receptive therapy for these patients, but it's a little bit, they have some side effects, as you know, for the other problems, but it is very, very important for the long-term usage. We have to be careful about the bone mineral density. That's why I showed you these slides.
Thank you.